Welcome back. That was the score. Just bringing us up to speed with the events as they unfolded. Very interesting stuff in the from the international scene. The English Premier League taking shape. The usual suspects are taking their position, but Manchester City seems to have stamped the authority, and it is theirs to lose as Liverpool keeps getting into bad space. Manchester United really keeping the fight for Arsenal, Chelsea, and the rest. It is a catch-up game. But looking at what happened in the local scene, congratulations to Michael Olunga and, of course, Paris Chepchirchir for being named the Sports Personality of the Year in terms of Soya Awards last weekend in Naivasha. Congratulations to all of them. And like mentioned, big talking points. Morans stunning 11-time African champions Angola, beating them 73 points to 74. Just a single point difference. The most interesting bit in that game was that with 2 minutes to go, Morans were leading by 8 points, 2 minutes to go. Then the real Angolan, team spirit came in. And all of a sudden, 5 minutes to go, it was Angola leading with a single point. But what a dummy by Ongwae and a two-pointer, giving Kenyans the win with only the buzzer left to go. The beauty about it as well is the buzzer went when the ball was already aired. Airborne getting into the net. 2 points for Kenya, giving them that historical win. Of course, Kenya having made it finally to the FIBA AfriBasket back in after 28 years of absence. Congratulations to the team, but we also know that Gor Mahia didn't get it as they thought. Unfortunately, they were bundled out by NABSA of Zambia, making it not a good season from them in the continental scene. But back in the local scene, Tusker seems to be getting a grip of what's been happening in the local league. Well, a lot lined up this weekend. We'll be keeping an eye, and in our subsequent news bulletins, we'll be letting you know what to expect and what the results were from the sporting scene, both locally and across the borders. Like promised, we have lots to talk about, but first, let's talk about a sport that last year many were really looking forward to. When it was about to happen, then the unprecedented the COVID-19 pandemic struck and the tournament was put on hold. It is a tournament that has always put Kenya in the global scene due to the international nature of the tournament and, of course, the global attention that it's attracted with all and many of the TV channels are glued and focusing on Kenya. We are talking about the Kenya Open that had been renamed to the magical Kenya Open due to the nature of the tournament that it's been. Unfortunately, when it was just about to happen, then the worst thing happened. The COVID-19 pandemic struck and the tournament was cancelled in the dying, in the last moments when it was just about to happen. Everything was in motion for the same. But the organizers never looked back, accepted it as it was and said there is always a tomorrow. And like many say, there's always a silver lining in any situation. They took it up and now we seem to be back on course because the magical Kenya Open has been slated to happen between the 18th and the 21st of March. That's a couple of days to come and all is set. Is it just the magical Kenya Open? Is there a new introduction? What's new about that? We are privileged and honored to be joined by the tournament director, Magical Kenya Open, Mr. Patrick Obath, who is always on call anytime you want updates around the Magical Kenya Open. He is here with us in studio to just give us a glimpse of what's happening. How prepared are we? Who is taking part? Are there entries? And are we likely to see the big names coming up into the country? All that will be answered, and of course, we are privileged and honored to have Mr. Obath with us in studio. Good afternoon, Mr. Obath, and thank you for making time to be with us.
Good afternoon, and it's my pleasure always to
come in. Thank you.
Most welcome. Well, last year, when it was all set and it was just about to go down at the current country club, unfortunately, in the last moment when all was set, COVID struck and you had to put it on hold. Since then, a lot has happened. Please, take it away.
Yes. That Friday announcement by the government that they were locking down the country and cancelling all sports took us aback. We had the TV crew already in the country. They had laid out all their infrastructure and were ready to start doing pre-event shots. Players were just, some of the players had arrived, and all the officials were here as well at that time. And it was a big blow indeed to us as an organizer, because and all the sponsors that we had already lined up by that time, Kenya Tourism Board, ABSA as a bank, EABL as the breweries, Hemingway's, all the organizations that had come together to help us stage the event. Just everything went. And literally the investment just vanished like that. So it was a big blow to everybody, including ourselves. And we tried three or four times, hoping that COVID would improve. And we sort of kept having new dates. And eventually, come round about October last year, we said, we can't call it the 2020 Magical Kenya. We have to just go to the next event, because if we do it and then we try and do this one this year, we wouldn't have been able to actually manage the logistics for that. So here we are. We have an event this year, the Magical Kenya Open 2021.
Patrick, it seemed to be a bit painful for you guys, the organizers then, but you took it with a pinch of salt and never looked back, always believed that there is tomorrow. We are set 18th to the 21st of March. It's coming down. The question is, what's different from the previous one? Because this time round, there is a rumor, and you will confirm whether it's a rumor or not. There is the Savannah also coming up, which means we might end up having two in one tournament.
That is absolutely correct. We have two events this year. We have the Magical Kenya Open, which was already scheduled from November last year, once the calendar for 2021 was being done by the European Tour. So that was already we were preparing for that. And then about 2 weeks ago, we were approached by the European Tour and asked whether we could hold another event in the country. And we quickly had to go through and speak to all our stakeholders, the government, the Ministry of Health, everybody involved. And we got a resounding please go ahead from almost everybody. So we have a second event this year called the Magical, the Kenya Classic, Kenya Savannah Classic. And that event is one that will run from the 23rd to the 26th of March. So effectively, the Magical Kenya Open 18 to 21, and the 22nd they have a rest, and then 23rd to 26th we have another 4 days of golf. And we will have a field that is very strong. As a result of having two events back to back, we are having a lot more players coming into Kenya this year, of a higher caliber and quality than we would have had if we had only had the Magical Kenya Open alone. And this, the main reason for this is that the European Tour, we now operate in what are called bubbles, and I'll explain that, which is an isolation. And it's quite an arduous situation for the players. So it makes sense for them to come and play two events back to back. It happened for the first time last year in Wales, where they had two events back to back, and then in December they had two events back to back in Cyprus. So we are the third country now that is having two events back to back within the European Tour.
You've mentioned bubbles, and like you said, you will clear. It's been the talk in major international tournaments, and it's been followed strictly. And by the end of it, we've seen successes around the major tournaments that are coming up. Are we set with the whole bubbles framework in terms of receiving all the golfers coming in, and of course not just those coming in, the locals as well, to ensure that we have a safe tournament this time round? But as we look at that, you can interact with us at KBC Channel 1 at Ampher A and let us know your thoughts. I'm seeing at Velona Atieno is asking, and are we allowed in as fans as well?
Yes, this year we unfortunately we're not going to have spectators coming in. The whole issue that is that COVID is still around with us. We have to continue with having live sport and making sure that spectators can watch, but they have to watch from the safety of their homes. That is the mantra across the whole world. So for the players, and this will explain why you're not having spectators, for the players to come into the bubble, it's quite an arduous thing. They have to, first of all, get tested and be tested negative for COVID. So when the players leave whichever country they are leaving to come to Kenya, they will need to have been tested like any international traveler coming into Kenya. When they arrive into the country, they will have to go through the same COVID checks like any other traveler. But this is where the difference starts. When they arrive in the country and before they go to the hotels which are set out for the players, and these are exclusively for the players and the officials and the cameramen and so forth. So these hotels, we've taken them up completely. And that is in total four hotels have been taken up completely, and they will be used exclusively. So before anybody goes into that hotel, they will have to have a COVID test on site, even after arriving with a COVID certificate from wherever they're coming from. So they'll have to have a COVID test. And once that COVID test is negative, they'll be allowed to enter now what we call the bubble. And the bubble is the hotel, which is exclusive, the clubhouse where they're going to eat and sit, which is going to be exclusive, and then the course, which is going to be exclusive to them as well, so that they don't interact with anybody else who can either bring COVID to them, or they give COVID to other people. So it is completely separated, and they will play, and they will go straight back to the hotel. They will go nowhere else. The transport from the hotel to the course and back is exclusively for that period of time, for the 8 days. The 10 buses we're going to be using are going to go nowhere apart from there, and they're going to have to be sanitized every time they've traveled and so forth. So it's quite an exercise staying in that bubble. And every day when they come, like all of us, they'll have to have their temperature checked, and then they'll do it also at random during the course of the day. So it's quite involving.
Mr. Obath, as you mentioned that, that clearly means that every person who will be involved directly with the tournament will have to be within a specified hotel, the drivers, the caddies, the organizers, yourselves as well. You will all be under one umbrella in terms of, accommodation, in terms of movement, even within the course and the clubhouse. Everyone will be under one, under one roof.
I'm not quite. The players, the caddies, and the officials who are in direct contact with the players all the time will be the ones who will stay in the bubble. There are other people, for example, the people who are preparing the course on a daily basis. They will go through the normal checks that all of us go through. And once they've gone through the checks, they will have a wristband saying they have been through those checks. So if you're found anywhere on the course without a wristband, which means you've not been checked, you'll be kicked out of the course. And the people like the guys who are cleaning up the course, they'll do that early in the morning, then they'll go and wait somewhere. And in the event we need them, we can send them out there. But then they won't be in touch with the players, but they will be in the same place where the players are likely to be. So we want to be sure that they are not, they're not bringing COVID in, into the course. So say almost 80% or 85% of the people involved will be in the bubble, and 15% are going to be outside.
Well, very interesting, Patrick, because it is the norm, not just here in the country, but even in the other international tournaments that we've seen taking off and very successfully held. And by the end of the day, we all see successes and very good ratings of the same. As we look at the tournament so far, it's days away. You mind letting us know how many entries so far? Are we likely to see any big names coming up into the tournament? Any past winners coming in?
Yes, I think the entry has been very good. In fact, by Friday, yesterday, the number of people who are interested in playing in both events was over 200. And the field that we will have is a maximum of 156. And of those 156, as usual, we have 6 amateurs, and then you have 150 players. Of the 150 players who are playing the professionals, we will have 15 of them having qualified from the safari tour, and then another six or so as special invites coming into the event. So there's a lot of demand for people coming in. And if I just look quickly at the entry list that we have, winners of the Rolex Series and the World Golf Championship. These are the major events across the world. We have three past winners coming in, which is Aaron Rai, who, if we all remember, Aaron Rai won in the Challenge Tour in 2018, the last one that was held as a Challenge Tour. And Aaron Rai's mother is from Kenya. So it's the first time he's coming back, and he's coming back as a major winner from the tour. And so we have a small connection with him as Kenya. And then we have Brandon Stone from South Africa and Chris Wood from the UK. These are people who are past winners of major events. And then past winners of other big events in the European tour and in the American tour, we have another 13 of them who are coming as well. So it's a great attraction to have the two events back to back, and it's giving us a very, very strong field.
As you talk about the strong feed that's coming up, you introduced, a very big tournament here in the country, and that's the Safari Tour, a couple of years back. You had objectives, and as we look at what's been happening around, it seems to be growing every year, and numbers going up. Are you achieving your objectives with the Safari Tour?
Yes, indeed. For us, the Safari Tour was premised on ensuring that we are giving local professionals a chance to play at a high level to improve their golf. So when we started, we had a field probably of about 28, 30 people, and most of them were Kenyans, a few Tanzanians, and a few Ugandans coming in. By the time we were having the last event last week, we had a field of 78, and the 78 players we had represented a total of six countries. And some people came just for the practice from South Africa, some of the Sunshine Tour people. So the Safari Tour has grown, and we are really pleased by the development that is happening in the Safari Tour. One of the great things that we're seeing is that the quality of play that is coming out of our local professionals has improved in leaps and bounds. If you look at when we started in 2018, the first Safari Tour event, the players could not play play golf after 4 days scoring anything under. There were always so many strokes over the value of the course. But as of last week, we are getting players playing 14, 13, 12 under the rating of the course. So that is very, very good in terms of the improvement in the quality of play of the people who are playing in the Safari Tour. And that is really very, very gratifying that you are beginning now to see local players playing at that level. The second thing that has happened because of that increase in numbers is that we are seeing a lot of younger players coming in to the game and turning professional. Because before that, it wasn't very good. We had only a lot of older players and so forth. So right now, at least, we have young people coming in.
Well, interesting, because this must be making you feel happy when you started off. You started off small, but you see the numbers increasing by the year, which is a very good thing. But as we look at the local competition, very interesting seeing that it's really growing. We saw Zimbabwe's Robertson Chinyoi, putting in a very brilliant fight. But the most interesting is how bullish our boys are on a light note. We also indies are saying kijana moja tu anajifanya anajua golf. Very interesting. Such light moments really bring a lot of life to the sport and makes it very interesting and competitive. Patrick,
yes, what you're seeing is a developing camaraderie between all the players. The players from Zimbabwe, players from Malawi, we had players from Nigeria, we've had players from Senegal, Rwanda, Uganda. And the fact that they're able to joke around with each other like that means we are getting a crop of people who are working together as a team. And they enjoy playing together, they enjoy challenging each other, and they all take it in the spirit of play. And that for us is the important thing, that it's not as though it is us and them, it is them together as players. And so when you had Indiza sort of trying to have a joke with Chinoy, we were really happy that the two of them could actually do that. And he's actually been called, they call him Mugabe whenever they're walking around and you know, we're taking photographs with them and so forth. They came, hey, Mzee Mugabe, come here. And he's also learned Swahili. So that is really good. It shows that that we are bringing people home into Kenya.
Well, interesting, because as we look at all that, it shows that the Kenyan game, you know, the Kenyan locals are also picking up very well and, you know, throwing the challenger to the other international golfers coming up. A very interesting twist to this year's Magical Kenya Open, Mr. Obath, is we have a deaf golfer, that's Isaac Makoha, playing at the, you know, Mount Kenya, not Mount Kenya, but the Magical Kenya Open. Very interesting and a new twist to golf in the country.
Absolutely. One of the things around golf is that golf, the skills of golf are in such a way that all you need is to understand where you go to hit the ball, then the mechanics of playing the ball come in. And it's good to have Makoha playing in as a deaf person. He's obviously got his support around him that makes that happen. About 4 years ago, we had a fundraiser and we had three blind people play. Now people are saying, so how can a blind person play golf? And the objective of the game is to go to a place that you can see. And they have their own people who set them up. And once they've been set up, they hit the ball. And they are told it is so far and they're given the right club and they play. So golf can be played by almost anybody, and I think that is the key thing. And thank you, Isaac, for having done that, because it just shows that golf is a sport that anybody can enjoy.
As we look at that, very interesting indeed, because the way you've accommodated Isaac as the organizers clearly shows that you are opening it up and you are sending a message that you can as well take care of the abled differently, and you've opened up the field. What's now the next step in terms of ensuring that there is continuity and we can get more of Isaacs coming in?
I think the first thing is to open up at the, what I call the entry level. Traditionally, golf has been viewed as an elite sport, elite people sports, rich people sports, and everything else. And when you see people like Isaac, different table people coming to play, and originally you found a lot of caddies coming in now, and you're finding now people coming in from all sorts of walks of life coming in to play golf, it is good that we're able to open that. But it's not yet quite open at the grassroots level. And one of the things we're doing at the moment, and not us as Kenya Open Golf Limited, but the Kenya Golf Union, who are the custodians of golf in the country, amateur golf, is to ensure that the game of golf is included as an authorized co-curricular activity in schools. Because up to now, the schools do not have golf listed as one of the sports that students can do in their spare time, which means that if students go and play golf, they do it outside of school time. And that has restricted the growth of golf. If you remember, rugby started off as an elite sport and then it was opened up in schools, and you found that all of a sudden, in fact, Western Kenya became the hub of rugby in the country. Yeah, because of that that opening up. So golf needs to happen. The same thing needs to happen to golf. And we are aware that at the moment there are discussions taking place with a new curriculum to include golf as part of the co-curricular activities. And when that happens, I am sure we are going to find a lot more people coming into this game, and we are happy to accommodate people of all abilities into the game. It is possible. People play with different abilities all around the world, and the facilities and the techniques are available, the different kinds of clubs, different kind of training, and those will be brought in the minute there is interest.
Patrick, I wouldn't disagree with you at all, because if you want to get results at the top, you must ensure the base is well taken care of. And seeing schools like Lenana coming up with golf courses clearly is the right way to go. And at the moment, Kenya Secondary Schools Sports Association or Kenya Primary School Sports Association pick up this and encompass and also accommodate it as part of the you know, co-curricular activities like any other sports, it can really pick up and a lot of competition at a very young age. Patrick, what's the prize money this time round? It is going to be difficult because we all understand the nature and times that we are in. Sponsors are, you know, coming in slowly by slowly. It might not be the same. Is the prize money still the same as in the previous years?
We were very lucky that the prize money that had been allocated for last year has been allocated this year. So that is still locked in. So you're very lucky with that. And then with the second event that you're having, the Kenya Savannah Classic, we also had the European Tour, which decided to put in a million euros into the pot. So the two events have got exactly the same prize money. And for that, we are forever grateful for the government of Kenya through the sports fund, which has been given to us through the Ministry of Sports, and then KTB, who are the ones who are going to be using that to market Kenya. All that is part of the response by the government to actually promote the game of golf in the country. And then the European Tour, who we've had a very good relationship with, and they've really worked very well with us over the last 25 odd years when we've had them as part of, you know, we've been part of the Challenge Tour and now the main tour. They decided to choose Kenya when one of the events was dropped out. They said Kenya is the right place. And just so that we encourage our people in the country, the main reason why they chose Kenya was the fact that wherever we took them, as we were preparing for the magical Kenya Open, they saw how well Kenyans are looking after themselves in response to COVID. And that was the main reason why we did that. So they came in and said, we like what you do, and they gave us the event.
Well, very interesting there, because you've mentioned the European Tour and Kenya being the focus and the focal point, good for the country. And as we look at all this, you mentioned earlier on fans and spectators will not be allowed in, which is totally understandable due to the nature and times that we are in. In terms of accessing the magical Kenya Open on television, has all that been closed so that fans can enjoy in their living rooms this time around, as opposed to walking through the course?
Yes, we have what is called a free-to-air channel that will be used for broadcasting within the country. So some of the local stations will have free-to-air transmission, and it will be live from 11 o'clock to 5:30 in the evening when the events close. All the 4 days that will happen. That is free to air. For those who have got subscriptions to subscription channels from satellite and whatever it is, it will also be available. And there will also be from certain producers as well. We are going to have live internet transmission as well. So there's going to be a lot of ways of watching the event. So if you're in the office or you're working at home, you will have that as well available. So there's a lot of ways that local or our local people can watch what is going on in the course. And even as you say, there's going to be no spectators. I think a few of us who are working there will be able to watch. So the players will not be completely isolated. They'll have a few hand claps here and there, even as they play on the course.
Well, interesting enough, because many are used to the hand claps, seeing the crowds, seeing people walking the course and following the golfers. But unfortunately, this time around, it won't be. But we can still do the same in our living rooms, like Mr. Obath puts it. Patrick, I want to play for you, the Indiza light moment during the award ceremony the other day. Very interesting, because Indiza clearly taking up the challenge and challenging others in terms of this. I don't know whether my director has it on standby, and if yes, please, this is the moment that we can hear what Indiza had to say. Very interesting indeed. Please.
Hii kuwa ni jambo kidogo kushinda vijana, unajua wamechifanya, wanajua kukufu kidogo. Hiko mmoja tu ndio anajifanya anajua golf. Golf hakuna mwenye anajua golf. Golf kila kitu lazima ukue uweke Mungu mbele kwanza. Bila Mungu wewe ni bure. Jana nakuja hapa naongea vibaya, tukasema sawa wewe. Kweli unajua golf, wewe cheza peke yako. Tungesema cheza peke yake ndio ashinde. Lakini zawadi ni kubwa. Iko zawadi ni 20. Sasa ukiingia mkono ya kwanza unaenda kutoka mwingine anarudi paka mtu ya mwisho hapana kuja kusema ati sisi najua golf. Sisi hapana. Kama angejua golf angecheza huko nje. Lakini nafurahia sana watu hii sponsor kama Safari Tour bila wametusaidia hivi sana. Tumefurahia sana kwa sababu tumecheza golf na tunacheza na moyo mmoja. Tunaona hii game hii mchezo ikiendelea hivi tutakuwa hawa vijana wetu wanaweza kuendelea mzuri, tunaweza kangumu, tuone kama Kenya Open kama tutaweza kumaintain vile tumecheza.
Interesting indeed, Patrick, your comments about indeed are very bullish, but at the same time bringing light moments in the game of golf.
I mean, Indiza is an icon in Kenya, I mean, in terms of golf. He has been around on the golf scene for a long time. He was amongst the first Kenyans to be able to play very good golf and make the cut and do a lot of things. He's a much older player than most of the others, and he comes from a place where the facilities for golf are not like a lot of the golfers here. So if you know the story of Indiza and how he has got to where he is, and now he's what they call, he's a senior golfer more or less, he should be playing on the senior tour. But he's still here with all the young people. I think he, having been around, you know, near winning for the last four or five events that we have, I think for him to eventually break through, first of all, to be able to make the tie at the end, they were tied with Chinoy. And then they went around an extra four holes, and he beat him on sudden death. I think for him it was a great thing for him to happen, for that to happen. And I think it's in his own inimitable way, he had to sort of breathe it out and let people know, really understand that, yeah, I really feel good. But at the same time, recognize the fact that there are a lot of people who are sort of clipping at his heels in terms of trying to take over the, you know, that role, that position of being the reliable, dependable golfer who will always come through at the end. That's what he's always been. But I think now with the Chinoys of this world, the Greg Snows, and the other younger people who are coming in, Indiza now has got a lot on his plate to watch out for.
Well, you've given us a lot that many didn't know. Indiza coming from a very humble background, but light moments and, of course, taking it to the opponents. Patrick, before I let you go, or before I get your parting shot to Kenyans around the magical Kenya Open coming up and the Kenya Savannah, you must be following other sports. Last week, history was made. For the first time in 28 years, our basketballers managed to qualify for the Afro Basket coming up. Morans beating 11-time champions Angola. How excited were you when you heard that?
I mean, I'm excited that a lot of the sports that traditionally Kenya has not been seen as a strong nation in the last few years are beginning to now have an impact globally. The first one obviously is golf is now coming up. Basketball. I mean, that is something that we've had a lot of people playing basketball and so forth. We've seen people from Sudan who are playing in the US. We've seen people from, you know, from Angola, from all over there, from Nigeria, who are playing in the United States. But Kenya, we don't have anybody. So this, for me, is an important breakthrough, because it means that a lot of people are now going to have their eye on this nation that they've ignored in terms of basketball. And all of a sudden, they've broken through and they beat Angola. It's like when our cricketers beat West Indies.
Correct.
In Dubai, I don't know, it was almost 30 years ago, right? That put the spotlight on Kenya, and see what happened to cricket. Unfortunately, it went the other way, right? But I hope that with this thing happening with basketball, it will actually make sure that now we maintain the quality, we have better local leagues, and that is an important thing. We need to have good local leagues so that the talent is discovered, nurtured, and then you have the talent spotters coming into the country and we begin to export players. In golf, we want to do exactly the same thing. The Safari Tour is one that we're hoping will grow and eventually allow people to come in as spotters to look for talent, and they pick them up and then go and start training them internationally. Every sport in Kenya must do the same.
Every sporter in Kenya must pick up and do the same. I'm so impressed when I hear, you know, your understanding of basketball as well. When you mention teams like Sudan, Nigeria, powerhouses in Africa, Angola. I didn't know you know that, but very interesting to note that once a sports person, always getting to know what happens. Patrick, you have 30 seconds to give us your parting shot. Kenyans are watching. What can you tell them?
we have unusual situations in the country for golf, and the only reason you can play golf is because it's played in the open. For those of you who will not be able to come to Karen, which is most of you, please make sure that from the 18th to the 22nd, 21st, and then from the 23rd to the 26th, between 11 and 5 o'clock every day, you watch live TV. Look through your channels, search through there, and you'll find live TV on your channels. And let us support our local Kenyans, if not just by talking about them and by giving tweets, going on social media, look for them and just give them a pat on the back and say, go out and represent our country.
Go out, represent our country. Thank you very much, Patrick Obath, Tournament Director, Magical Kenya Open, coming up, in a couple of days' time. We appreciate you making time for us. Up next, we're going to a short commercial break. When we come back, the history-making Morans are here in studio. Up next, commercial break.